students and welcome once again to my channel English Made Easy with Mandeep. And today we will be taking up a very easy topic of English grammar, that is sentence and types of sentences. So children, when we talk to each other, when we communicate with each other, like right now I'm talking to you, if the communication skill of a person is not good, that means if the person is not able to frame good sentences on his or her own, then what will happen? There is a lag in communication, means there is a barrier in communication. You will not be able to tell your point of view to the other person because you will not be able to frame a proper sentence. So sentences therefore play very important. Sentences are very important whenever you are writing any article, any notice, whenever you are conversing with someone, whenever you are writing your answers. Okay, so sentences are very important. You have to write the answer in a proper sentence, and if your answer would be grammatically wrong, then what will happen? You will not fetch good marks. So that's why today I have come up with the topic sentence and types of sentences. So we will be doing sentence first. I will teach you what a sentence is. So children, if we talk of a sentence, means for example, if I say I am going there, so this is a sentence. So how will we come to know that this is a sentence? A sentence, children, always has a subject and a verb. A sentence without a subject and a verb is not a complete sentence. Just remember this thing. What is a sentence? A sentence is a group of words. When we join few words together, for example, I said, I like to dance. So I have joined a few words together and I have made a sentence, I like to dance. And most important thing, whenever we are framing a sentence, children, for example, can you see the sentence here on the blackboard? Teacher, the teaching is. Do you think it's a sentence? Can you make out something out of this? Teacher, the teaching is. I hope not. This is not a sentence. Although this sentence is having a verb, this sentence is having a subject also, okay, and still this sentence is not a correct sentence. So most important thing, what do we learn? We learn this, that whenever we are writing a sentence, we have to keep this into consideration, that whatever we are writing is at its appropriate, means the correct place. The placing of the verbs, the placing of the subject or the object or the other things in the sentence is very important, right? So this sentence is wrong. But if I write it this way, the teacher is teaching. So now this is correct. We are getting a meaningful sentence, that the teacher is teaching. So what is the teacher doing? She is teaching. So this is a correct sentence. So we have to keep this in mind, that we should not write wrong sentences, rather we should write correct sentences by placing each and everything at the right place. So therefore, what do we conclude? We conclude that a sentence is a group of words. And what kind of groups of words? This is which has an idea, or you can say a thought and a purpose. What is the purpose of the teacher? The purpose here is that she is teaching, right? Then the sentence should have a meaning. It should not be a meaningless sentence. Like this sentence was, teacher, the teaching is. It was a meaningless sentence. Okay, so meaningless sentences shouldn't be there. The sentence should have a meaning in it, right? Then again, the most important thing, a sentence should have a subject and a verb. A sentence should always have a subject and a verb. We'll do some more, like cat mews. So So cat is the subject and muse is the verb. Cat is the subject. So this is a complete sentence. It has a subject and it has a verb. For example, Neha sings. Again, Neha is the subject and sings is the verb. Again, the sentence is complete, right? And if I say, we'll take another sentence. Ravi plays basketball. So again, we have Ravi as the subject because it is doing the work of playing. It is playing, which is the verb. And what is it playing? It is playing basketball. Okay? So this is the object. What is Ravi playing? He's playing basketball. So this is the object of the sentence. But the most important thing is a sentence should always have a subject and a verb. Then the sentence is said to be a complete sentence. So I hope this much is clear. You have understood what a sentence is actually. What do we call a sentence? A sentence is called a group of words which are set in proper grammatical way. That is called a sentence, right? So now we'll do types of sentences. Sentences is clear to everybody. But sometimes children, what happens? The subject is, it's hidden. Okay, it remains hidden. It is not there. And we have to just find out where the subject is. And usually it happens in imperative sentences. Imperative sentences means those sentences in which we portray as if we are requesting somebody, or we are commanding or giving order to someone. Okay, like sit down, go there, come here, okay, pull up your socks. So these are the few sentences in which we do not write the subject, but it is understood, and this kind of subject is called implied subject. What are they called? Implied subject. For example, if I write a sentence, keep the bag on the table. Keep the bag on the table. But here, do you find any subject? No, there is no subject here. Right? So here the subject is you, and this you is implied subject. What is it? This is implied subject. Like, we are assuming that there is someone there in front of us and whom we are giving this command, that keep the bag on the table. So these are called implied subjects. Okay, so two kinds of subjects are also clear to you: implied subjects and normal subjects, which we have done earlier, right? So this was all about sentence. And and children, now when you have known what a sentence is, so now we will discuss about types of sentences. The types of sentences, we can categorize the sentences on the basis of the kind of thought it has, or on the basis of the kind of expression it is conveying us. So we can divide the sentences into four different parts. So let us study those four different types of sentences. Okay, students, so in types of sentences, first of all, we'll do declarative sentences. As the very word says, declarative means you are declaring something. You are giving some information. There is a statement which you are making, or you are talking of some facts, right? For example, if I say the sun rises in the east, so it's a fact. So it is a declarative sentence. For example, the earth revolves round the sun. So it is a declarative sentence. So this is called declarative type of sentences. And every time, children, these declarative sentences, they end with a full stop. Okay, I'll take up another example, children. You can see here, grow in soil. So I have declared that the plants, they grow in soil, and it's a fact that plants, they grow in soil. So this is a declarative sentence and it is ending with a full stop. And this sentence, plants is the subject. We are talking about plants. And where do they grow? Grow is the verb. So this is the subject and this is the verb, right? So this is a complete sentence and we are declaring this, that the plants, they grow in the soil. For example, if I say I am a vegetarian, I am a vegetarian. So again we will end it with a full stop. That is very important. We have to punctuate a declarative sentence with a full stop. I say I am a vegetarian. So I'm declaring, I'm giving a statement that yes, I am a vegetarian. Okay, like we can say I make videos. So I'm declaring that what do I do? What is my job? I make videos, right? So this is my job. Or you can also say there are like the pudding is tasty or delicious, whatever. If I say the pudding is tasty, so I'm declaring it, I'm telling this to someone that this pudding which has been made is very tasty. So these are called declarative type of sentences. Now children, when we talk of declarative type of sentences, the declarative sentences are positive. See, whatever I have written here in all these four sentences, whatever I have declared is all positive. Okay, but then there are sentences which are negative also, children. Like these negative sentences negate a thing. For example, we can convert these also into negative. For example, if I say plants do not grow in soil, so I am negating it. So I have made this sentence into negative. When I have added do not to it, I have made it into a negative sentence. I have changed it. Then we take to the second one. Look at this. I am a vegetarian. If I say I am not a vegetarian, okay, then again this shows that I am not a vegetarian, means I am a non-vegetarian. So when we add not to a sentence, then it becomes a declarative negative sentence. Now if you look at the sentence, I make videos. So I'll say I do not make videos. I don't make videos. So if I'll say this, I don't make videos, means it is a declarative sentence only, but a negative declarative sentence. Now we come to the last one. The pudding is tasty. And if I say the pudding is not tasty, okay, if I'll say the pudding is not tasty, then it will become a negative sentence, right? So this is the difference between a positive sentence and a negative sentence. The negative sentences have do not or not in it, and the positive sentences do not have the word do not and not. Is it clear to everybody what the declarative sentences are? Okay, declarative sentences give facts, statements and information, and they end with a full stop. Is it clear to everybody? I hope it's clear. So now children, we move on to another set of, or you can say another kind of sentences, and they are interrogative sentences. Interrogative. They are interrogative. So interrogative sentences are those sentences in which we interrogate. Interrogate means we question, we ask a question to someone. For example, what is your name? Where do you live? Okay, which work do you do? Right? So these are the kind of interrogative sentences. For example, if I say, have you done your work? So this is again an interrogative sentence. Whenever we ask someone a question, that is called interrogative sentences. And children, these type of sentences, they end with a question mark. This is the punctuation that we use in interrogative sentences. And usually interrogative sentences are used whenever we ask a question with WH words. Okay, like how, what, when, who, whose, where, whom. So these are the words. I'm writing it here. What, who, whose, whom, when, where. Okay, so these are the words that we use to ask a question from somebody, right? For example, what do you do? Okay, or what are you doing right now? So this is again a question. Example, the second one is with who. Okay, who are you working with? So this is again a question. Then whose name is Neha? Okay, this is again a question. You're asking a question from someone that whose name is Neha? Who's Neha over here? Then whom did you give your notebook to? So this is again a question. When did you go to the market to buy the groceries? So this is again a question. You're asking somebody that when did you go to the grocer's shop? Where is your father? Right? So this is again a question. So these type of questions that we ask from somebody, they are called interrogative sentences. I hope it is clear to everybody what interrogative sentences are. So now we move on to another set of sentences that is called imperative sentences. So children, the third type of sentences, as I told you, are imperative sentences. Imperative sentences are those sentences in which the expression is that of command. You are commanding somebody, you are ordering somebody. Okay, you are ordering your subordinate, or for example, you are telling someone to do some work for you. Okay, like the teachers, what do they ask? They ask you, bring your notebook to me. So this is an order. This is an imperative sentence. Okay, so not only orders or commands, we also request. Whenever we are requesting somebody, then also we can say that this is an imperative sentence. For example, please give me this pen. So this is an imperative. You are requesting somebody to give a pen to you to work, right? So this is called imperative sentences. We'll take some examples now. For example, look here, children, see here. Go there. So somebody is ordering to someone to go there. For example, the owner is ordering the servant to go there. So this is an order. So go there, right? Then we can take another example. Wait for me. This is again an imperative sentence. Wait for me. It's again an imperative sentence. Then let us take one more sentence, children. Bring a glass of water. This is again an imperative sentence. But as I told you, children, that there are implied subject also. When you will look at these sentences very carefully, you will not find any subject here. Go there. So who will go there? So this is automatically clear that here there is implied subject that is called you. That is called you. For example, you go there. You wait for me. You bring a glass of water for me. Okay, so these are called implied subject, and usually in all the imperative sentences we have implied subjects, that is called you. Okay, so I hope this much is clear to you all. Imperative sentences are clear to everybody. So now we come to the fourth one, that is exclamatory sentence. Exclamatory sentence. So these are the kind of sentences which end with an exclamatory mark. You know what is an exclamatory mark? This is called a mark of exclamation. So these sentences, they end with an exclamatory mark. For example, children, when we talk of exclamation, we talk of a very strong emotion. We talk of a very strong feeling. That feeling can be of strong sadness. That feeling can be of a lot of enthusiasm. That feeling can be a very happy feeling when you are very, very happy, when you are very excited. And it can be when you are feeling very low, you are very sad. So you can say a strong feeling or a strong emotion when you have to portray, when you have to talk to someone in order to portray your strong feeling or your strong emotion, then what do? Then you talk in exclamation. You talk, that type of sentence is called exclamatory sentences. For example, we can take the example here. If I say the tide is too high. The tide is too high means the tides in the ocean, they are very, very high. I can't imagine. I am amazed to see that the tides are so very high. So there we will write this sentence and we'll add an exclamatory mark here. And then what a beautiful scene. What a beautiful scene. So here again, what do you see? You see that the scene is very beautiful and you don't have words to express them. And then you are expressing it like this. What a beautiful scene with an exclamatory mark. And then if I say, he is... he is such a nice boy. Again, an exclamatory mark means that particular boy is very, very good. He is very, very nice. Okay. Let us talk of some more sentences. For example, if I say, if I look at a building and that building is very tall. Okay. So what will I say? What a tall building it is. Okay, what a tall building means that building is very tall. Okay, so this is showing my amazement. So then when we are very sad, how will we say? How will we portray when we are very, very sad? We'll say, alas, he is dead. So now when I am talking of a sad thing, I'll say alas. So these are the words which we can use to show our emotion of sadness. Okay. So this way, this is called, these are the types of exclamatory sentences. An exclamatory sentence, I again repeat, shows a very strong feeling, whether of happiness or of amazement or of terror or of sadness. Right? So this is portrayed through these kind of sentences and ends with an exclamatory mark. If you will not put an exclamatory mark, then your sentence will not be called an exclamatory sentence. Otherwise, your marks would be deducted if you will not put this, right? So this was all about exclamatory sentences. Children, there are one more type of sentences which are called optative sentences. So, optative sentences are the sentences in which either you bless someone or you curse someone. Okay? For example, whenever we say, may God bless you. Okay? May you be blessed. So, these are the sentences. Whenever we use these kind of sentences, for wishing, means we are wishing good to someone, we are blessing somebody, or we are cursing someone, okay, like casting an evil on someone. So these are the sentences which are called optative sentences. But most importantly, usually we talk of only four types of sentences, and they are, first of all, declarative, then interrogative, then imperative, and then the last one is exclamatory sentences. So this was all about sentences, children. We'll do a small drill in order to in order to see how much we have comprehended in this session of sentences and types of sentences. So children, here is a small drill of 10 sentences. So let us do it quickly and let us see how much you people have comprehended. So the first sentence says, my name is Dilip. So this is what kind of sentence it is? It is a declarative sentence. Dilip is declaring that my name is Dilip. So this is a declarative kind of sentence. I'm writing D here. What are the students doing? And then there is a question mark. So if there is a question mark in any kind of sentence, then immediately it should strike your mind that yes, it is an interrogative sentence. So I'm writing here I. Earth revolves around the sun. So this is again a fact, a geographical fact, which we know that the earth revolves around the sun. Again a declaration, so I'll write here D. It's a declarative sentence. How poisonous the snake is. Okay, this is showing terror, this is showing amazement and a feeling of fear. Okay, a strong feeling of fear. And there is also an exclamatory mark, as you can see. As soon as you look at this exclamatory mark, immediately it should come to your mind that it is an exclamatory sentence. So you will write here E. So again, I have one more sentence is there. Submit your notebooks. Like your teachers, they ask you that submit your notebooks. So what is this? This is kind of an order which the teacher is giving to the children that you have to submit your notebooks. So this is again, what kind of sentence it is? It is imperative sentence. Okay, I'll write here I am to differentiate. It is imperative sentence. So what a green landscape. Well, means there is a landscape, there is a beautiful scenic region, and you are spellbound looking at that beauty. There is a strong emotion, and also there is a exclamatory mark here. So again, this is an exclamatory sentence. Now we come to the seventh one. It says, let us go out. So this is again an imperative sentence. It is like a request. We are here requesting somebody, let us go out. You are just advising someone, okay, come on, let us go out. As friends say to each other, let's go and have a coffee at the at CCD. So this is a kind of an imperative sentence. It is advising someone that let us go out somewhere. Then we have the eighth one. Alas, the famous actor passed away. So this is again a sad news, and you can see alas, after alas I have put an exclamatory mark here. So this is again an exclamatory sentence. Now we come to the ninth one. Call the doctor. Okay, so call the doctor. In this sentence we have what? Imperative. You are ordering someone to call the doctor. Somebody is not well and that person is saying that you better call a doctor. And one more thing children, when in this sentence if you see call the doctor, you will not find any subject here. The subject is an implied subject. Here somewhere you will have to add you to it in your mind when you think, and if you say you call the doctor. So therefore it becomes what kind of sentence? Imperative sentence here. Now the last one, please stay at home. Children, these days coronavirus is taking toils of lives of the people. So I would request every one of you that you people better stay at home. Please stay at home. So what am I doing? I'm requesting you people that you better stay at home. Please wash your hands at regular intervals so that you are safe and sound at home. So this is again an advice. I am requesting you people that you people better not I'm requesting you people that you should keep washing your hands. You should stay at home. So this is an advisory from my side to you all. So this is again a request. Okay. So this is again, what kind of sentence is it? It is imperative sentence. So I hope children, after the drill, this must be very clear to you. What are the types of sentences and what are sentences? And secondly, what are the different types of sentences? children, in the description you can even find the worksheets. I have placed two worksheets also, and you can just have those worksheets and keep on practicing them, right? And keep on practicing them, Jamal.
Yes.
And if you have liked my video, then do not forget to subscribe my channel. Do press the bell icon so that you keep on getting the notifications of my upcoming videos. Thank you.